السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اما بعد ان استك حديث كتاب الله تعالى واحسن حديث حديث محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر امور محدثاتها وكل محدثه بدعه وكل بدعه ضلاله وكل ضلاله في النار الحمد لله all praise is due to Allah azza wa jal we praise him and we extol him and we seek refuge in Allah azza wa jal from the evil within ourselves and the evil results of our wrong actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can be led astray. And whomsoever Allah allows to be left in misguidance, there is no guide for that person. Verily, The most truthful of speech is the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the most evil of our fears are the newly invented ones. For verily every newly invented matter is a bid'ah, a going astray. And every going astray leads to the hellfire. A'udhu billah. Alhamdulillah. Today, inshallah, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I would like to speak about a global phenomenon which has taken place. A phenomenon that has been sweeping across the globe, which is the disease of materialism, my dear brothers and sisters. This is something which has affected all of mankind. And la hawlana wa la quwata illa billah, this also includes the Muslimin. This also includes the Muslims. This disease, this sweeping disease of materialism has been spreading rampant across the whole of the globe. And alhamdulillah, there's a few who have now begun to waken up and realize that this disease isn't something that they want spread into their households. La hawlana wa la quwwata illa billah. But the sad part is the majority of the Muslim Ummah has also become affected by this disease of craving after materialism in their lives. So today, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I would like to take us on a brief journey back in time to the Quruna Mufaddala, to the blessed time period of the early days of Mecca Mukarrama, where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his Sahaba, the very small band of Ashab at that time, enjoyed a very great period. In that time, in the early days of Mecca Mukarrama, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and that small band of believers were suffering great hardships at the hands of the Mushrikeen of Quraysh. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sheltered by his uncle the majority of the time. Until after his death, they started to put pressure on the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the small band of the believers. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and those believers, they suffered great atrocities at the hands of those Mushrikeen of Quraysh. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and those believers, they suffered so much so that they hardly can find anything to eat. In that early period of Mecca, and the early period of when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the small band of the believers were receiving that revelation, the whole time the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reminded his community, that small band of believers, to remain patient. He always reminded them to remain patient. In that time of severe atrocities and hardships that they were put through, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam coined that generation as a Khair Qurun. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam called the generation and time period that he was living in as the best of generations, is his generation. And what was so good about that generation, you might ask? They were put through severe hardship and tests and trials and tribulations, time and time again, only because they said, La ilaha illallah. They weren't out giving da'wah. It was only the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam who would go out and call his people to Tawheed. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would only say to his people, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُوا. But my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the majority of mankind right now have been plunged into the craving and seeking after wealth, madly seeking after wealth and status. In the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were not seeking after wealth and status. And they were not blessed with abundance of wealth and status, like we are seemingly blessed with an abundance of wealth, an abundance, a great abundance of wealth. They, in the time of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, especially in the early period of Makkah Mukarrama, they were blessed with the halawat of Iman, the love of Iman and the seeking after Iman. For example, in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were boycotted. There was a social boycott that occurred in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the early period of Mecca. They were boycotted to such an extent that nobody was allowed to do business with them. They were not allowed to buy and sell with the Muslims. This is what happened in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were boycotted and they were pushed to the mountains, to the outskirts of Mecca, and they were told to survive on their own. They were pushed outside of Mecca by their own people. Why? Just because they believed in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were not busy giving da'wah. There was a small group of believers who believed in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they were plunged into that period of, they were plunged into that severely hard period of starvation. They, as Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu, coined that period by saying that we had to live on a starvation diet. This is what the great Sahabi Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu said. And this noble Sahabi Abu Hurairah, he only spent 3 years with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It wasn't in the early times of Mecca where he experienced that severe level of hardship, when they had to survive on eating leaves, dry leaves, and they had to survive on eating the roots of trees, and they had to survive, literally, on eating the skin of animals for a period of 3 years. When the Muhajirin reached to the Ansar in Medina, after 12 or 13 years of going through hardship, and after coming through that severe period of boycott, social boycott and alienation, and they reach to their brothers of the Ansar in Medina, and they would talk about the period that they spent, that period of hardship that they spent while in Mecca, and that especially difficult period that they spent of the social boycott. The Ansar, they asked him in amazement, how did you all survive that period of 3 years of social boycott? How did you survive? How did you feed your families? They said, we survived on crushing up the dried leaves that whatever we could find, and crushing those leaves into a paste and mixing it with some water and feeding it to our children. They had to survive on dried leaves as a staple food to feed their children. The cries of their hungry children were heard night and day. This is how they survived in that severe hardship, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. But nowadays, there's a rampant disease which has spread worldwide, that the majority of mankind have run after materialism, running into the habit of saying that and claiming that we cannot do without the latest gadgets. We cannot do without having our own device. Everyone must have their own device. You have in one house 5 or 6 different types of devices at the hands of each and every member of the family, young and old. They have to have their own device. Everybody is now greedy. Greed and selfishness. Greed and selfishness and self-centeredness has become rampant all over mankind. Everybody has been afflicted by this disease. You have now children saying that they have to have, they must have, they need to have their own device. We have high-speed internet. We have every type of food available at our fingertips. We have Indian food. We have Afghani food. We have Pakistani food. We have Guyanese food. If we don't want to go out to get the food, all we have to do is just make a phone call and we'll have it delivered hot to our house. So subhanAllah, with all of this materialism now, we are not getting more advanced in our lives. As a result, bil'ax, the opposite has occurred. With all of these materialisms at our fingertips and ease of comfort, we have the rampant spread of widespread diseases of diabetes, high blood pressure, and schizophrenia. This is a disease that is becoming widespread, that people are suffering from high levels of stress and anxiety. Why is these things happening in our society, especially here in the West, when this is the land where everything is available? We have everything available. We have all of our needs and wants. We have fully availability of everything that we want. But yet, this disease of materialism has been widespread, has become widespread amongst the ummah, the whole world. And it's a funny thing, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. When we speak to the Muslims, we say, Alhamdulillah, we're Muslims. Alhamdulillah, Rasulullah, he came to us. But no, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah azza wa jalla said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to all of mankind. بُعْثْ لِلنَّاسْ كَافَ. It wasn't like the time of the previous prophets and generations of the Bani Israel. The Prophet Musa alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet Isa alayhi wa sallam was sent, he said he was sent to the lost tribe of Israel. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to all of mankind. Allah azza wa jalla says in Surah Al-Isra, قُلْ يَا أَيُّوَ النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ordered by Allah azza wa jalla to say to mankind that verily I, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was sent to all of mankind together, to the thaqalain, to the jinni and ints. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent and went through all of that suffering and hardship, he went through what he went through for the good of mankind, for the good of humanity. So when we hear about yani the difficulty that the Muslims are facing right now with the new law that the government is planning to pass, we should reflect when we think about ourselves that we should just take our children out. Then what about the rest of mankind who will, as a result of this new curriculum, become affected? We are living here and Allah Azza wa Jal had raised us up. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, كنت خير أمة أخرجت للناس تعملون بالمعروف وتنحون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله وأتوب إليه. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه هدى وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, when Allah Azza wa Jal, He says regarding the Ummah, meaning us, that we were the best nation, كنت خير أمة أخرج للناس, ever risen up for the guidance of mankind. Why? Because we enjoin what is right and we forbid what is wrong. And then we say we believe in Allah. But nowadays we're doing things in the opposite. We are claiming to be the best. We are saying Alhamdulillah we're Muslim. Alhamdulillah we have Iman. But we have to be concerned about our fellow neighbors in this society. Allah Azza wa Jal caused us to come here. So Allah Azza wa Jalla has placed a great responsibility on our shoulders. We cannot become like everybody else. We cannot become materialistic and self-centered and greedy and stingy just like everybody else. Because the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was not like that. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was not a poor man. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whatever he had, he would share it. He would give it freely and openly. That's why the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was known as Al-Amin. He was known as Al-Amin. He was known as the upright, trustworthy man. Before Allah Azza wa Jal commissioned him as a prophet, Allah Azza wa Jal astafa Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah Azza wa Jal, he chose Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was sent to all of mankind. The black, the white, the Arab, the non-Arabs, Indian, everybody. بُعْثْ لِلنَّاسِ كَافَ. He, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was sent to all of mankind. As what? Rahmatin lil alameen. Allah Azza wa Jal, He gives us an example, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Why I'm mentioning this example now is because a lot of us have been lost and have been plunged into this disease of materialism. We have all kind of devices and we have every kind of food that we can imagine at our fingertips. But are we imposing on ourselves a self-imposed death sentence by indulging in all of these fancies and fallacies of life? Are we imposing on ourselves a self-imposed death sentence, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam? Because these things are readily available. It doesn't mean that we have to indulge in everything that we get our hands on. I want to leave us with one ayah and an example. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he said, whomsoever Allah Azza wa Jal, we're talking about blessings, my dear brothers and sisters, that in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were blessed. Allah Azza wa Jal blessed them with Iman. They were put through severe hardship and difficulty, social boycott, and for years they had to sustain themselves and their families on dried leaves, made into paste and a mortar, and made and fed to their children, and the skins of animals, and roots of trees for years. And Abu Hurairah who said that, if you would have seen us living on a starvation diet, Al-Hasan al-Basri, He said, Rahimallah. And when you hear these words of the noble Imam, Al-Hasan al-Basri, let us look to ourselves and the lives that we're living and think about the life of the Prophet ﷺ and the Qurun al-Fadla. Khair al-Qurun, the Prophet ﷺ, he said about his generation was the best generation. And they had hardly anything to eat to survive. They had hardly anything to clothe themselves with. But the Prophet ﷺ called that generation the best of generations. We have everything that we can ever imagine. And the technology is going forward. Listen to what the noble Imam of the Sunnah, Al-Hasan al-Basri, says in regards to blessings in this life. Al-Hasan al-Basri said that, whomsoever Allah Azza wa Jal gives provision, and he thinks that Allah Azza wa Jal is not testing him, he has no wisdom. I'll repeat, the noble Imam of the Sunnah, Al-Hasan al-Basri, he said that whomsoever Allah Azza wa Jal has given rizq, in abundance, provision, and he thinks that Allah Azza wa Jal is not testing him, has no wisdom. And on the opposite side of the scale, whomsoever Allah Azza wa Jal has given little provision and thinks that Allah Azza wa Jal will not look after him, after some time will provide for him, has not been given wisdom. And then he, the noble Imam, Hasan al-Basri, Hamallah, he recited the verse in Surah An'am, ayat number 44. فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْضَةٌ فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. Then the noble Sheikh Hasan al-Basri, he recited this ayah, which is in Surah An'am, ayat number 44. So when they forgot the warnings, why was the Prophet ﷺ and all the Prophets sent? Mubashirin wa mundirin. They were there, they were sent to give glad tidings of paradise and the vastness of paradise. And mundirin, and to give warnings. If you disobey Allah, if you do not pray, if you do not fast, if you do not do what Allah Azza wa Jalla told you to do, then you're going to go to the nar. Mubashirin wa mundirin. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in this surah, in this ayah, so when they forgot the warnings of the prophets and the messengers and those who followed them, which they have been reminded of, then we opened up the doors of all things to them. فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Allah Azza wa Jalla then opened up the doors of everything for them, every goodness. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, until they were in the midst of their enjoyment, when they were in the midst of their enjoyment, after giving all of those good things, and then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, all of a sudden, took them. We then took them and punished them. They were just looking in amazement and staring like an astonishment that they had all of these things, and all of a sudden, this thing just happened to them. They lost everything. All of us know of a story of somebody who was engrossed in all of the wealth and fancies of this life, and all of a sudden, he was afflicted by some kind of punishment. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. The noble Sheikh Hasan al-Basri, after reciting this ayat, he said that, Wallahi, رب الكعبة. Hasan al-Basri said, Wallahi, he swear by the Lord of the Kaaba, Allah Azza wa Jalla deceived these people by way of giving them all of this wealth. By giving them all of this wealth, fancy cars, nice SUV, nice clothes, nice house, lots of money, extra money in the bank. We have money for rainy day, and then we have money for another rainy day, and another. We keep on piling up and piling up and piling up of our wealth. And then he says that, Wallahi, he said, by the Lord of the Kaaba, Allah Azza wa Jal, he gave them whatever they wished for, and Allah Azza wa Jal caused them to be deceived by what they had. And as a result, destroyed them. They destroyed themselves. Are we not living, my dear brothers and sisters? Are we not imposing on ourselves a self-imposed death sentence by craving after all of these things? Allah Azza wa Jalla, if He gives us something, then we have to start by being shakiran. Biman an'am Allah alayna. Be what Allah has given us. Is what Allah Azza wa Jalla has given us a blessing or is it a punishment? Is it a punishment in disguise or is it a blessing? It's up to us to evaluate that. We have to self-evaluate ourselves. That when we get more money, when we get more wealth, when we buy 2 and 3 and 4 of things from a supermarket that we know are just going to go to waste, then we have to evaluate ourselves. That when you allow your children to eat or to drink and eat half of the food and you throw away the other half, who are you feeding? When you see your child drinking half of the juice and you throw away the other half, who are you feeding? We have to always keep that in our mind. I'll leave us with a noble hadith on the authority of Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu, who said, and this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Abu Hurairah, he only spent 3 years with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He only spent 3 years. And he said, if you would have seen us living a life of starvation, of a life of starvation, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met Abu Bakr as-Siddiq one night and Umar sitting down outside in the middle of the night. Abu Hurairah who was narrating this hadith, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met Abu Bakr and Umar sitting outside one night. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked him, why are you guys sitting outside at this late hour of the night? And they said, Abu Bakr and Umar said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wallah, they said, by the one who sent you, ya Rasulullah, with the truth. The only reason what brought us out at this hour of the night is hunger. Severe hunger. And the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wallahi yani bi nafsi alladhi ba'athni bil haqq, the one who holds my soul in his hand and who sent me, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the truth. The only reason why I'm outside at this time of night is due to hunger. Can you imagine, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam? Which one of us has ever woken up in the middle of the night because we're hungry? Whenever we feel a little bit of hunger, we rush to grab a snack. We never suffer any hunger in this part of the world. It's very rare to find anyone who's here who's suffering from hunger. And if we feel the slightest little pinch of hunger, we right away we grab something to eat. So that until we get home, food is ready at home, hot and fresh, ready. Alhamdulillah. We've been blessed so much. So when the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr and Umar went with him, ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ said, come. And they went to the house of one of the Ansari men. We all know this author. If we do not know, then let me remind you that Allah Azza wa Jal, he revealed the surah, Al-Hakm al-Takathir. Allah Azza wa Jal called this surah, yani this race and haste for this takathir, piling up and gathering up and wanting to amass of wealth is something that leads us astray. Everybody is running. Allah talked about that. This surah was revealed in the time of Mecca, Muharramah. And Abu Bakr and Umar were recanting and talking about that time period. And Abu Hurairah, he heard about their discussion and he narrated the hadith. They weren't talking about it as just to complain. Abu Hurairah wasn't in the time of Mecca. It's when they were in Medina, they were talking about the hardships that they faced. Not out of a way of complaint, but just talking about the incident that took place. Because as a result of that incident, Allah Azza wa Jal, he revealed an ayah, the surah of Quran, that they will be asked about the blessings. Because when the Prophet ﷺ took them to the house of that Ansari man, they ate food. He slaughtered for them a sheep. They ate meat. They ate dates. They drank milk. And then the Prophet ﷺ said that you will be asked about this na'im. You will be asked about this blessing that you left from your houses hungry and you're not returning except when your belly is full. How many of us, my dear brothers and sisters, have come here to this land, this blessed land of milk and honey, and have taken part, we have worked. We come here hungry and thirsty and malnourished without very much knowledge, or maybe we came with great education, but we came here looking for a better life. And alhamdulillah, Allah bless us with a better life, bless us with a good job and a good family. We have to say alhamdulillah. We have to be thankful for that blessing and give back. It's time to look for ways and means to give back, to show Allah Azza wa Jal that we're grateful for that blessing that Allah Azza wa Jal blessed us with. Because if we don't, it might be a source of our punishment here and hereafter. May Allah bless all of us with the understanding that not everything that glitters is gold. And that if Allah Azza wa Jal given us more, we should understand that it might be a test. Allah might be testing us by way of this blessing of abundance of wealth. May Allah bless us, inshallah, and give us the tawfiq to be living in the middle course. And know that when we have, we should remember those who do not have as much as we do and look for ways to give to them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على السلام حي على الفلاح قد قامت السلام قد قامت السلام الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
So, make your line straight, brother. Don't leave any gaps for Shaitan. Jazakallah khair.